Call the meeting to order, roll call, please.
Mayor Rankin?
Here.
Vice Mayor Walter?
Here.
Councilmember Woolridge, absent. Councilmember Hawkins? I'm sorry, Councilmember Hawkins?
Oh, I'm sorry.
Councilmember Gilliam?
Here.
Councilmember Anderson?
Here.
Councilmember Wall?
Here.
Mayor, we have a quorum.
Thank you, we need a motion.
Make a motion to adjourn to executive session.
Second. We have a motion and a second to adjourn to executive session, any other discussion? Hearing none, I'll call for the question, all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign, motion carries. Need a motion, please.
Make a motion, we adjourn from executive session.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to adjourn from executive session, any other discussion? Hearing none, I'll call for the question, all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign, motion carries. Lisa?
Gonna have a moment.
Let's see, we go to, ladies and gentlemen, at this time, we'll take a moment of silence and also remain standing for the Pledge of Allegiance. Thank you. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you, please be seated. This will be our first call to the public for public comment on issues within the jurisdiction of the town council. Council rules limit public comment to 3 minutes. Individual council members may respond to criticism made by those commenting, may ask staff to review a matter raised, or may ask that a matter be put on a future agenda. However, members of the council shall not discuss or take action on any matter during an open call to the public unless the matters are properly noticed for discussion and legal action. Lisa, do we have any requests?
I was not given any requests, sir.
If anybody has anything I'd like to say at this time, please come up to the podium, state your name, where you live.
Thank you.
Seeing no movement, I'll close call to the public. I do want to apologize for the lateness of the meeting starting. We were in executive session with attorneys, and they look a lot better than I do. I was on the short end of that stick.
Item A, public hearing on a conditional use permit request by Chris Newman on behalf of property owner John Off to allow for an indoor commercial recreation facility with the downtown commercial zoning district at property located at 301 North Main Street, Florence, Arizona, and discussion approval disapproval to adopt resolution 1581-16, a resolution of the Town of Florence, Pinal County, Arizona, approving a conditional use permit to allow for an indoor commercial recreation facility within the downtown commercial zoning district at property located at 301 North Main Street, Florence, Arizona. Mr. Eckhoff will be presenting.
Mark. Good evening, Mayor and Council. I think I can make this case pretty quick. The applicant came to us a while back and wanted to start a CrossFit business in town. He's been operating in the city of Coolidge for a while and was excited about coming over to town here. So after looking at a variety of locations, came upon the location here at what we know most recently as the old Blue Adobe Conference Center. We looked into the code and we found that there was, for some reason, an indoor recreational facility required a use permit in the DC zoning district, which the property is zoned. So a couple of things. We thought that was, number one, something that we should change in the code because we didn't want to prohibit this type of use. So we are working on a text amendment, but we also knew that we didn't want the applicant to wait around for the text amendment to get completed, so we started the use permit process. And the town, for the record, we actually did cover the cost of the application for the use permit. So that, I guess, is already showing you where we're leading on our recommendation. We did have a neighborhood meeting, we had a Planning and Zoning Commission meeting, and across the board, whether it's staff or the public or the Planning Commission, there is a lot of support for this particular use. And it is a conditional use, though, nevertheless. And so we do have to ask ourselves the questions about whether this use is compatible at this location. We've addressed those questions. We have findings in the report. The Planning Commission supported those findings that in turn supported a favorable recommendation to you for this case. And we're really excited to get to this point here tonight where we can have a public hearing on this item, hopefully have a resolution approved by the mayor, by you, Mayor and Council. And Mr. Newman is getting all geared up to start his business tomorrow if all goes well. We've been working with him on getting the building ready, getting his business license to be issued, and he's really excited to be here, and the property owner as well is here with Mr. Newman as well, if you have questions for either one of them. And I'd be happy to address any questions you may have. You'll find that in the resolution, we really don't have any conditions of approval other than they receive a certificate of occupancy for the facility, which they are working on doing so.
Okay. Do you members of the council have any questions?
I have just one question. In the write-up, right before item A on page 2, there's a sentence that says, over time, the town may close or relocate the current facility based on the service needs of the community and funding. What circumstances would cause that to happen?
Well, Member Wall, Mayor, members of the council, I think that's really a very generic, vague statement, just a reflection that there's been a consideration in the past, and probably we still have that consideration, and that the town wasn't necessarily looking to compete with private enterprise when it provide a fitness center or recreational facility. So should an entity come in that really fulfills that need, the town may want to reevaluate whether we would continue to provide that service. In addition, that facility that we have today may not be able to compete with some of the newer facilities that come in down the road. So it's just a general statement that for now, these two uses are unique enough that we don't feel that we would be in direct competition with Mr. Newman. But down the road, that may change.
Thank you.
I guess my question is, does this include the restaurant part as well as the bar part?
Mayor, members of the council, yes, it goes all the way from the entire length of that building. And it is just in that end of the building. I know previously the next suite over had been kind of merged into that in previous uses. But it is just the whole linear part there along the street.
Okay, there's three buildings there.
Mm-hmm.
Right? The bar, the restaurant, and that little building where they cut into it.
Okay, they are in the old saloon part. So you come in off the corner, and you can, and basically it's a shotgun style building all the way to the back. There is still the next suite over where the previous tenant had located the restrooms, for instance.
Okay. Now, are the restrooms in this facility for public?
The restrooms, interesting enough, are actually in the adjacent suite, and there is a property line going down there. So they are looking at the opportunity of maybe acquiring that property potentially, and then the restrooms might be able to serve both spaces. If not, we are willing to issue a temporary occupancy permit for them. Until they can equip this facility with restrooms. With the type of the use, they know, obviously, it would even, beyond being a code item, it'd be beneficial to have restrooms with the type of use in here.
Okay. Now, another question is there any sales tax redeemed from this?
Mayor, members of the council, on a service, I'm not sure, but I believe if they happen to sell any products, there would be, certainly. But I'm not sure on the service part. And the finance director may answer that differently.
Okay. Dave, if I saw you shaking your head, there isn't any.
Not on the service, sir.
Thank you. So in other words, that's considered a service instead of a retail establishment?
That is correct, Mayor.
Okay. Any other questions, members of council? Okay, at this time, I'll open up the public hearing. Does any member of the public have anything they'd like to say? Jim? Happen to know your name?
I can't resist the temptation. I think this business, no pun intended, is a good fit for Main Street. You know, the revival of Main Street, even 8-10 cars make Main Street look lively. So we need to do everything possible to make these people successful. I'm very much in favor of it. But I'd like to remind you of something, maybe I said too much in the past, but the arteries that feed Main Street, if we consider the heart being Highway 79, 8th Street needs attention. Ruggles looks pretty good. 1st Street is a disaster. So let's keep in the back of our minds for perhaps 2017 that 8th Street needs attention. That's a major artery coming from 79, and it'll help these people. Because with all those corrections officers working out there on the east side of 79, it's got to be nice coming down to Main Street. I'm very much in favor of this. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other member of the public? This is one thing I will mention. This is we talk about competition between the town and private enterprise. From what I understand, from what we're providing down in our facility, doesn't really, it's not in competition with, I don't believe it's in competition with you. My daughter was a client of his, and she was driving to Coolidge. So I know a little bit about the program. I think it's an upstanding program, and I think it's gonna make a good deal. If there's no other comment, I will close the public hearing. Now we need a motion on the resolution.
Make a motion to adopt resolution 1581-16.
I'll second.
We have a motion and a second to adopt resolution 1581-16. Any other discussion? Hearing none, I'll call for the question. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
Item B, public hearing to receive public comment on the alternative expenditure home rule option and first reading of resolution number 1582-16, a resolution of the Town of Florence, Bunnell County, Arizona, proposing an alternative expenditure limitation home rule option. Mr. Gabe Garcia will present tonight.
Good evening, Mayor and members of the Council. Tonight we have the first of two public hearings in preparation for our August election. Cities and towns contemplating the adoption of an alternative expenditure limitation or the home rule must hold two public hearings for comments on the proposed action. The home rule option will allow the town council to set its own expenditure limitation for a four-year period beginning not this next fiscal year, but the 17-18 year through the 2021 fiscal year. I'd be happy to answer any questions you may have.
Any member of the council have any questions, Gabe? Okay, at this time I'll open the public hearing. Does any member of the public have anything you'd like to say about our home rule option? Seeing no movement, I'll close the public hearing.
Item C, resolution copper presentation by Andrew Tafton, Project Director. Mr. Billingsley will be presenting.
Oh, Andy, where have you been, buddy?
Mr. Mayor, members of council, as you're aware, an article was published in our local paper about a month and a half ago talking about Resolution Copper and a facility that they do plan to build in the future, being in the town of Florence. As you know, we've had conversations as such that facility would not be in the town of Florence, our boundaries or our planning area at this time. We held a couple of different meetings with Resolution Copper to get further clarification, and it was requested by resolution that they be able to come in front of the council and give us an update as they have in the past. And so tonight we have the pleasure of having Mr. Andrew Taplin here to give us an update on the Resolution Copper Project.
You're welcome.
Thanks for the introduction, Brent. Mayor Rankin, Vice Mayor Walter, Council Member Woolridge, Council Member Hawkins, Council Member Goulin, Council Member Anderson, and Council Member Wall, thank you very much for the opportunity this evening to come and present. I know how busy you are, and we're very appreciative of this opportunity. There were three things that I wanted to cover, and I know that I do have limited time on your agenda, so I'll move through them reasonably swiftly and allow some time for some questions and answers. The three areas I want to cover is our safety performance on the project. That's our number one priority, keeping people safe, so I'll provide a brief update on that and how we progressed last year. We have commenced the permitting process for the project, and I'll provide a brief update on that, and then I'll get into some of the information on the proposed filter plant site, which is close to the town of Florence. Safety is our number one priority, and we had a good year last year. We worked particularly hard to keep all of our employees and our contractors safe and ensure they went home to their families and loved ones in exactly the same condition that they came to work. We were recognised by the National Mining Association with the Sentinels of Safety Award, and Resolution Copper was nationally acknowledged for safety performance by the National Mining Association. And as I mentioned, we did have a good year. I don't want to gloss over the fact that we had three injuries last year that required three of our contractors to receive medical treatment. I'm pleased to say that they're all back to work in their full capacity. They're all with the same contractor, and they're all with the on the same job. We've learnt a number of things from those particular incidents, and since have had a good injury-free period. As I mentioned, the project has commenced the permitting process. We're developing the project on federal land, which means that we're obliged to follow the National Environmental Policy Act of 1969, or NEPA. And prior to any commercial mining and prior to the exchange of 2,400 acres of land, we're required to go through a full National Environmental Policy Act evaluation. In November 2013, we submitted our mine plan of operations, and that went through a very rigorous review over a period of 12 months, and in December 2014, that was deemed complete. Just on the 18th of March, the Federal Register had an entry indicating that the Forest Service would commence the public comment process for the Resolution Copper Project, which indicates the commencement of NEPA. Public scoping meetings have commenced, and comments will be accepted until May 17 of this year. There have been four meetings. There was a meeting held at Queen Valley last week. There's a meeting this evening in Superior, a meeting tomorrow evening in Globe, and Gilbert on Wednesday night. There are four ways that the public can get involved during the comment period, and I think you've got a hard copy of a flowchart that we've pulled together, an infographic that we've pulled together, which indicate the four means by which folk can get involved with the comment period, and we'd really appreciate any comments that that you might have and the public's got. It'll only help us to better shape the project and come up with a better design and a better layout for the project to commence and operate in the future. Comments can be mailed to the United States Forest Service. Comments can be emailed, and we've got an email address on our flowchart. Comments can be made via a website, which is detailed on the flowchart as well, and also fax and voicemail comments can also be made, and there's a telephone number there. There's a fax number and voicemail number available there. So we're pleased to have kicked off that process. We do expect to be in the NEPA process for about 5 years, and by way of our regular project updates, as well as by way of the Forest Service, we'll keep all of the local and regional communities well apprised of progress. If I move now on to the filter plant near Florence, Resolution Copper owns a parcel of land, and if you're looking at the same diagram I am, which is, shows the little red parcel of land, that's the land which is about 550 acres that's been identified as a potential site for a filter plant. Currently, that land is zoned as residential land as well as categorised as employment land. And we're just going through the process of rezoning that to be categorised as employment, which is required for the development that we're proposing. You can also see on the diagram that the Resolution Copper Marco Corridor goes right past the land. And when we had a look at the overall design of the mine, the concentrator and processing circuit, we identified this being an optimal place both on the Marco Railway Corridor and close to the Union Pacific Railroad for a filter plant. The parcel is approximately 7 miles northeast of Magma Junction, and it's accessed via Skyline Road or via Highway 79. A little bit about a filter plant. The material that we're going to mine will come to the surface, and it will have been crushed, and will require a couple of further crushing processes before it's at a size it can be processed through the concentrator. The material will go through the concentrator, and waste rock will be removed and deposited in a tailings dam. And copper concentrate, with a copper concentrate of about 35%, will be available for downstream processing. When the material comes out of the concentrator, it'll have a moisture content of about 35%. 35% moisture content is too high for railing, and what normally takes place is the water is removed down to about 8% before it's placed on ore cars for railing out of the facility. The process that we will be using to remove that water is by using filter elements, and the filter elements are a process where the copper concentrate is placed on top of the filter elements. They're very fine filters of about 10 to 20 microns. It allows the water to filter out through the concentrate material, and then the drier concentrate is scraped off the top of the filter elements and is taken through to a stockpile for loadout onto a train. When we reduce the moisture content from 35% to 8%.
You okay?
Yeah. No, I'm sorry, Andy.
That's right, Mayor. Just want to make sure you're okay.
I need a beer. You're making talking that concentrate's got me.
When the moisture content is reduced from 35% down to 8%, that water is collected. It will be stored in a large storage tank of about 3 million gallons. That water will be then piped back up for future use up at the mine site, most likely in the concentrator, and there'll be some use of that water in the processing facility and with some of the material handling equipment at the filter plant. There will be a concentrate pipeline from Superior down to the land that's identified on the map, and that pipeline will be largely buried. There may be a few rocky areas where the pipeline will be above the surface, but it's planned that that concentrate pipeline will be buried below the surface. At maximum capacity, there will be about, at maximum capacity, there'll be about 110,000 tonnes of dried concentrate stored in a storage facility and under a covered storage facility at the location. We're expecting the construction period to be approximately 2 years. During that period, we're expecting that there'll be about 60 times by which vehicles will need to travel on and off the site, and we believe that that's a generous estimate, 60 times that vehicles will need to travel on and off the site each day during construction. Traffic can be reduced by way of the use of Highway 79 and then via the Marco Corridor. We're estimating during the construction period that there'll be about 100 people employed on the site. After construction, we'll transition into operations. Resolution Copper will be a long life mine, and we're expecting the mine life to be about 40 years. Over the course of the 40 years, we're expecting production to get up to a maximum rate of 120,000 tonnes per day. During that period, there would be an average of about 20 trips on and off the site. And during the operation period, we're expecting to be employing about 30 people on the site. The maximum level of concentrate through the loadout facility and through the filter plant would be on average about 2.2 million tonnes a year at peak production and up to 3 million tonnes. With train lengths of about 100 cars and 110 tonnes per car, at full production we could have up to 220 trains per year from the site down to the Union Pacific Railroad. Power for the site would be supplied from the 69 kV line from the Able substation, which is near the CAP crossing of the Marco Railway Corridor. There will be a number of environmental protections associated with the facility, a number of environmental protections that we're going to be obliged to comply with. It's anticipated that the facility will be a fully enclosed filter plant and fully enclosed concentrate loadout facility. This will help to prevent airborne emissions. We'll also be regulated under the Pinal County Air Quality Control Department. Cars will be loaded inside buildings to prevent dust and to reduce noise. Stormwater containment ponds will be required for all contact water on the property and on the facilities, and this will be regulated under the Arizona State Aquifer Protection Program. The concentrate pipeline will have a protection plan assessed under the NEPA process. Spill prevention control and countermeasure plan will be required, as will a stormwater pollution prevention plan, and that will be required by the state of Arizona. Environmental and socioeconomic impacts will be assessed under the comprehensive NEPA program. As I mentioned, we're expecting the NEPA assessment to take a full five years. So as you can see, there'll be a number of environmental protections that we're going to be obliged to comply with and will happily comply with. As I mentioned, I wanted to move this through this reasonably swiftly, anticipating a number of questions. So that's the material I wanted to cover, but very happy to answer any questions that you might have.
Turn that back on. Any member of the council have any questions?
I have a question.
Go ahead, John.
One thing you didn't touch on was the return pipe. Could you explain that to the audience?
Absolutely. Thanks for the question, Council Member Anderson. As I mentioned, there'll be a concentrate pipe which goes down the Marco corridor from Superior all the way down to the filter plant. There'll be a smaller diameter return water line, and that will go down the same water that will go down the same railway corridor and return that water back up to the processing facility for reuse in the processing facility. There may be a small amount of the recycled water that will be used for washdown and those types of things associated with operations of a filter plant with conveyor belts and those types of things, but we're expecting the majority to be recycled.
We're also expecting to be a small requirement for potable water for the workforce that will be working on the site.
But there'll be no residue left in this plant.
Say that again, Council Member.
There will be no residue that you'll have to deal with.
No runoff, John?
No runoff.
Yeah, so for the footprint of the installations that we have, any water that comes in contact with those, with that footprint, we will be obliged to catch and retain, and where we can recycle and reuse that water.
Okay, thank you.
So the ponds that you were talking about, those are strictly for rain and storms, right?
Stormwater collection.
They're not ponds that are going to hold solutions in them from the process?
No.
Right.
No.
Okay, I just want to make that clear because that's the way I understood it. Yeah, there wouldn't be any...
That's correct, Council Member.
Ponds.
The process that we'll be using is quite mechanical in nature. As I mentioned, the concentrate with 35% moisture content is deposited on top of filter panels. Those filter panels are very small, have got very small apertures, 10, 20, 30 micron, which allow drain underneath. And the drier concentrate material is then scraped off the top. And there'll be a number of these filter panels, obviously, to get the production rates that we require, scraped off the top, off onto smaller conveyor belts and into the stockpile material. So to your question again, those ponds are about stormwater collection. They're not about containment of water for use in the facility or chemicals for use in the facilities. The process is very mechanical in nature.
Okay.
I just have a couple of questions. Where the pipeline crosses 60 and 79, that will go under those roadways?
Yeah, that's what we're proposing at the moment, Council Member.
Okay.
Yeah.
And are there any pumping stations required to move the concentrate?
Yeah, there are pumping. There are pumping stations that will be required. I can't tell you the location of those. I can get back to you on that, but that concentrate, because of its density, will need to be assisted down the pipeline.
Thank you.
Okay, does anybody else have anything that they'd like to say at this time? Anybody from the public, would you like to say anything at this time? Okay, thank you very much for your presentation this evening.
Thanks, Vice Mayor. And we'd be happy to come back at any time and provide a project update, and perhaps we can work with your town manager, Brent, and schedule something in at the appropriate time so you're well apprised of how things are progressing.
We appreciate the communication.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Item D, presentation by Moore & Associates on the Central Arizona Regional Transit System and the development of a 5-year transit development plan. Mr. Knutson.
Vice Mayor, members of the council, as you're well aware, Florence is one of the members of the CART transit system, Central Arizona Regional Transit. We are in partnership with a Central Arizona College, with Pinal County, and with the City of Coolidge to provide bus transit services to the residents in the region. The CART was awarded a grant through ADOT to take a look at the existing operations and where we want to be in the next 5 years. So tonight is a presentation from Jim Moore from Moore & Associates on his findings to date, and to solicit comment from the town council on the CART system and where we want to go. So without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Moore.
Good evening, Vice Mayor, members of the council. Mr. Knutson indicated our firm was retained in late 2015 on behalf of the CART partners to develop a transit development plan. And a transit development plan, in simple terms, is a 5-year business plan or a blueprint for the continuing development of the CART program. The project goals included an objective and comprehensive evaluation of how CART and as well as the City of Coolidge's Cotton Express services were performing, both against adopted evaluation criteria, as well as a comparison with other similar small rural public transit programs in Arizona and beyond. And in doing so, to develop a blueprint for continuing service development, to identify future funding opportunities, both operationally and for capital, and then also to offer some recommendations for the future CART governance. CART currently is governed through a IGA between the four signatories that Mr. Knudsen mentioned. This project has included considerable community engagement, including a survey of all the CART riders, as well as a direct mail household survey to 1,500 households, 500 of whom located in the unincorporated county area, 500 within Florence, and 500 within Coolidge. And we've had about a 15% response on the household survey. We also had a series of stakeholder roundtables convened in each of the three communities noted there that were attended about, I think we had about 12 to 15 attendees at each. The attendees represented social service organizations, business organizations, educational institutions, et cetera. We have also had we set up information tables at 10 locations along with one of the CART vehicles throughout the service area, where we engaged the public. They were able to ask questions, pick up service information, et cetera. We have also maintained an interactive project webpage throughout the life of the project, where we have received several comments, as well as being able to post information on the project's progress. And then fairly recently, there was an article that appeared in the local papers discussing the project. Some of the key takeaways through the various community inputs, but whether it was the survey roundtables or the online comment, was a request for more frequent service on weekdays, the implementation of some sort of trial service on weekends, particularly on Saturday, to increase marketing and outreach activities, including enhancing information availability at the individual bus stops, to develop a peak hour weekday express service out to Casa Grande to some of the key employers located there, and then to also expand or introduce service into a variety of destinations. And this particular relevance to the council might be the request for service out to Florence Gardens, as well as out to the Florence Anthem area. And these are not listed in any particular hierarchical order. This is just a series of comments that have been received through various community input. Those are very quickly some of the comments that we also received through the survey on behalf of the City of Coolidge's Cotton Express program. Again, you can see it's fairly similar in terms of the request for some form of weekend service, increasing marketing outreach, and then expansion of their service to some of the currently unserved or low service areas. Some additional community feedback that we received included establishing a local circulator bus here in Florence. When I mean a local circulator, something that would travel throughout the town and then would link up with the long line service that would travel over to CAC and to Coolidge and perhaps into Casa Grande. And to develop a partnership with larger employers out in Casa Grande, perhaps through financial underwriting to support express peak hour service. And then finally, to investigate a partnership with the local Indian community from Gila River as either a full-fledged member of the CART IGA or perhaps through the purchase of transit services from that partnership. We've also been looking at some alternatives to the current governance mechanism. It currently is an IGA through those four signatories. The IGA expires later this year. When it was originally set up, it was intended, it was quite informal. Certainly times have changed. The program has further developed. There's been interest from other possible partners. And so we're looking at things from perhaps a JPA, perhaps develop some sort of transit district, just a whole variety of things, as well as perhaps a menu of services that various partners could purchase from the consortium. And looking for a mechanism to be able to include additional future partners, and how would they be able to buy into the IGA. So as we're nearing the end of the project, and the end of the project is anticipated for the end of the month of May, we're looking to actually finalize the service evaluation. We presented our findings to the CART board about 2 weeks ago, where we presented some initial recommendations. We received feedback from them. Through that process, we're now developing the preferred service plan, which includes a phasing approach of 12 to 18 months, 18 months to 36 months, and then from 36 months out to 5 years, depending upon both demand as well as the availability of financing. Developing a commensurate financial and capital plan to support those recommendations, taking the plan back out to the community to provide an opportunity for public comment and feedback, and then finally to finalize the project report. Mr. Mayor, members of council, I know that was a very, very brisk overview of a project that we have been working on now for about 7 months, I'm available to respond to any questions that you or the council may have.
Do any members of the council have any questions?
Well, we have our new water park, yeah, which is will be a summer activity, but we're hoping to get customers from Coolidge and Santan Valley, into that water park. It would be excellent. We had some kind of transportation program to help service that.
Well, Mr. Mayor, members of council, certainly we are aware of that possible trip generator, and that's been taken into account in some of the routing recommendations.
Thank you.
Okay. I do have a few questions. My first question is, when you say you sent out 500 questionnaires to the different areas, one of them being Florence, did you disaggregate the different areas of Florence, meaning, because as you know, we have three distinct populations?
Yes, there was. Actually, we sent out more in Florence than the other areas, particularly so that we could address that segregation that exists within Florence through the various residential areas.
So you sent a certain percentage up to Anthem, a certain percentage into Caliente, as well as Florence proper?
Florence Gardens, into Anthem, into what I would call Florence proper, this portion of the community. The survey, it was available both in English and Spanish. It also included a postage paid response envelope to engender additional responses or encourage participation.
Now, have you also posted anything anywhere whereas people can email into you, also give you feedback if by chance they were not solicited for that particular survey?
Yes, the survey was also available online. It is still available online. We still are maintaining the project webpage as we have from the project start, and it will remain in place until the project's complete. We've received several surveys completed online from locations throughout the entire county. We've also received quite a few questions, comments, et cetera, about the project through the online project webpage.
Okay. Could you give that information to Lisa? And Lisa, can you have IT put that onto our website so if residents would like to go ahead and complete that survey, they have that option?
Most certainly.
Okay. And also, I share the same concerns as John Anderson had just expressed. Over the past few years, I've expressed and worked with Jess regarding the transportation of having a local combined with the regional. Because, for example, we're offering swimming lessons down at the new facility. There's families that only have one vehicle. The husband takes it to work. We are in a rural area. There's a long commute. I'd like to see something in place so we can make that happen.
Well, Mr. Mayor, I want to make sure I understand the council member's question or comment. The way I'm interpreting it is, or perhaps I'll tell you what one of the recommendations that has arisen so far, and that was to bifurcate or divide the service so as to have the CART perhaps end down perhaps lower part of town where the Holiday Inn Express is, that area, and then also to have a separate bus that would just focus on Florence, Florence Gardens, perhaps the Anthem area. That would make time connections with the bus down there by the Holiday Inn Express so that we would be able to actually provide more service within the Florence area and yet be able to maintain on-time performance for the long line service. So I hope that's what the council members is getting at. That is one of the key, one of the first recommendations that has been offered.
Yes, and that's something that we've communicated back and forth for some time now.
There currently is not time available in the current schedule of the long line service to be able to come further into the Florence community.
Okay, now also, just out of pure curiosity, how much was the grant through ADOT for at that time that y'all received?
I don't know what the grant was. Our grant, our fee rather, is somewhere close to, I think it's a little under $150,000.
Okay.
And that includes all direct cost, mailing, travel, everything.
Okay.
But I don't know what the grant itself was.
Well, thank you for sharing that. I appreciate your time.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Jess?
Mayor, members of the council, thank you. A couple things with regards to the plan as it unfolds. Mr. Moore will be unveiling the five-year plan and be recommending some additional services, potentially some additional services for the Florence area. We've asked him as part of that plan to provide some general ideas with regards to costs. So additional services within Florence will have to be come back before council for the council to review it, services based on the cost provided. So keep that in mind, and that's going to be, as Mr. Moore indicated, some short-term and longer-term recommendations will be coming before the council in future years. With regards to the survey, residents right now can go on the town's website. We do have a link to that survey. Also, you can go on the town's Facebook account, and there's links to the survey. So the more comments from the public with regards to our transit program, they're certainly welcomed. The last thing I wanted to mention, on the next regular town council meeting on April 18th, as Mr. Moore indicated, the IGA with our three partners is set to expire this year. So on the 18th, I'll be bringing back the IGA for council's consideration for renewal. So if you have any questions about that or the study, I'd be happy to address those.
No, I got some questions. My pet peeve has been that we run the bus, we pay the cost of it and everything, and it goes to Casa Grande every day. Different positions in Casa Grande, not just to the Central Arizona College or not just to Walmart or not just to the hospital. Why isn't Casa Grande becoming a member of this?
Mayor, members of the council, you're voicing a frustration that has loomed large within the on the CART board and others that are interested in the transit system. We do go into Casa Grande at this time, largely in part because of some sponsorship revenues that we've collected, and additionally because of some county services that are identified within Casa Grande. Mr. Moore, Jill Dusenberry, transportation legend from City of Coolidge is in the audience. Both of those attended a meeting today with the City of Casa Grande, and Mr. Moore can expand upon this, but we are renewing conversations with the City of Casa Grande, and we're hopeful that we'll be bringing in an additional partner with the system, a contributing partner with the system.
If Casa Grande comes online, that's going to mean additional purchases of buses, I would assume.
In the short term, no. We would continue the existing system as it you see today. However, some changes to the system could take place that could increase the number of the buses that serve our residents and the ridership in the area. One of the things that we've spelled out to the City of Casa Grande is that if they want to have any type of influence on changes to the system, there's a seat at the table, and they're welcome to it. They just need to come with the responsibilities that every other paying member provides. So, short term, the answer is no. But long term, they'd be part of the process as far as what the changes would look like. And obviously, we'd incorporate the recommendations that Moore and Associates will provide with us.
And as we've developed this plan, we understand it's just a plan. that can be changed, and is the plan pretty easy to be changed once we're going down, as far as there's going to be different areas that come online that we're not really aware of at this time? Do you think that the plan, the routes that you have, will, like say if a big development goes in there, Valley Farms, can be included in that, you know, the plan be adopted?
Go ahead.
Mayor, members of council, I think one of the most interesting or beneficial aspects of this particular study is that it provides a variety of service enhancements that can be implemented either singularly or collectively, and also done on a phased basis in response to either demand and or available funding. So it is not, in simplest terms, Mayor, something that is either a thumbs up or, you know, thumbs down type of undertaking. I believe the plan is incorporates sufficient flexibility to take into account and to be sensitive to the individual needs and priorities of each of the partners.
Okay. Any other questions? Does any member of the audience have any question they want to ask? Does anybody want to talk to Jill? No? Okay, we'll go on. Thank you very much.
Item E, presentation from the 150th Anniversary Ad Hoc Committee. Mr. Hughes?
Good evening, Mayor and Council. We had a great event this past weekend. The Road to Country Thunder brought a lot of residents and visitors down to historic downtown. I'd like to thank the mayor and council members for being out there that evening and supporting it. I'd like to also thank Country Thunder and Camel 107.9 for helping to coordinate a lot of the main stage and all the great acts that were out there. It was really a great time. I'd also like to recognize the Parks and Recreation staff for all their hard work coordinating that event, and also police, fire, and all the other town departments that took part in it. It really did take a team effort by everybody. It was a great event, very big, and good for downtown, I think. So, as far as what's upcoming for the 150th, we're doing another movie in the park on April 16th. We're doing Disney's Inside Out at Padilla Park. That's a great family cartoon movie, so we expect a lot of folks to come out for that. Another event associated with the 150th, kind of a new one that we threw in there, was the Water Safety Day when we opened up the Aquatic Center on the 30th. That is a free event for everybody to attend. The goal is that if kids want to come out and test for certain levels of the swimming lessons over the summer, or parents want to get their kids signed up for those swimming lessons, that's a great opportunity to do that. So April 30th from noon to 5 over at the Aquatic Center will be open. And again, that's another event as part of the 150th. And then we're going to have a little bit of a break during the month of May of any major events, actually May and June, until we get to the 4th of July Freedom Fest. So just a little bit of a break while we while the weather heats up. I also want to remind Mayor and Council that the committee is continuing to look at new events for the fall, and we hope to have a detailed schedule of events ready for next month when we give our update. We're pleased to be working with a lot of different community organizations, the Mounted Posse, the Sons of the American Legion, Masonic Lodge. Everybody's coming to the table and just having some ideas and doing some of the legwork for us, so it really helps out quite a bit. And we hope to have, again, some of those things at least a little bit more finalized. It's hard sometimes when you're looking out to October, November, December to get some folks to commit. As far as sponsorship goes, we continue to seek out sponsors to help offset the cost of these events. We currently have a little over $22,000 in cash and probably about an equal amount in in-kind services, particularly Country Thunder was a huge contributor again this past weekend. Stage lighting, entertainment is a huge cost that the town did not have to bear. And then lastly, we do still have some of the merchandising and collectibles that we're selling. We can still buy banners up around downtown, and we have t-shirts and some other stuff available over at the library and community center, and also at booths at events. So that's pretty much the update for this month, unless the mayor, vice mayor, or council member Anderson, who are also on the committee, would like to add anything. And I'd be happy to answer any questions.
No, I think you covered it pretty well.
Okay.
We do have one camper over at Dry Camp, and those folks come in from Buckeye. And they thought that was the greatest thing in the world, is they can come down here, and they pulled in Saturday. They'll be here until Wednesday, then they'll be taken out to the event. But this is what I was looking at, is trying to get people to come in here so they spend two or three extra days here in Florence, maybe spend some money here in town for their merchants. And I think it'll spread after these people get through talking to other campers out there next year, so we should be a little bit better more.
Yeah, this year, Mayor, I'd just like to add, I think that was probably just a test case out there, and I think we have the ability to serve a certain amount of people over there in that parking lot without having it have much impact on the facilities there. And again, it does keep people in town for a few days.
Yep. And the event really went off great all the way up until 10 o'clock. We cut her down about an hour early. Hour and a half, or a half hour.
The entertainment ended about a half hour early.
Yeah.
Just went along a little quicker than we thought, so.
But there's only one police incident. I mean, and you're running an event for what, 8 hours, 8.5 hours, and you only have one, and there's alcohol being sold and consumed down there, and you only have one police incident. That was great. Kids up and down the street, it was just neat to see that, to see the kids out having a good time and not having to worry about anything. It was great.
Thank you.
And again, that was their second one. And talking with the people from Country Thunder, they want to make it better next year. So we'll be working with them. I don't have anything else. Brian, you got anything else? That's it? Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Item 9, consent. 9A, authorization to purchase 2 Barnes Influent submersible pumps for the utilities department from Pump Systems in amount not to exceed $28,868.84. Item B, approval of amendment number 3 to extend the intergovernmental agreement between the State of Arizona Parks Board and the Town of Florence for McFarland State Historic Parks operations. Item C, proclamation declaring April 2016 as Fair Housing Month in the Town of Florence. Item D, authorization to re-enter into a cooperative agreement with the State Forester, superseding all previous memorandums of understanding and cooperative agreements for the protections of its forests and wildlands. Item E, approval of accepting the register of demands ending February 29, 2016 in the amount of $1,538,301.83. Mayor, members of council, that is your consent agenda for this evening.
Does any member of the council want anything taken off the consent agenda?
Yes, I'd like to have item B taken off.
B?
Yes.
Okay. Any others? Need a motion?
I'll make a motion to approve the consent agenda, removing item B.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the consent agenda with the exception of item B. Any other discussion? Hearing none, I call for the question. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. Motion carries. John?
Just a couple questions for Jennifer. There's one of the things that was added was the Junior Ranger program. What's that about?
Mayor Rankin, members of the council, the Junior Ranger program is a program through Arizona State Parks, and each park participates in it, and it's specific to each park. So, as I understand it now, State Parks will be working with our local staff members to develop the Junior Ranger program specifically for McFarland State Park, but it's where they bring in kids when they visit the park. They have special activities and questions and that they're expected to answer, and then they earn a badge at the end of their visit for completing that little program.
That sounds good.
Gives them a deeper understanding.
Yeah, yes. Sounds great. Another question I had was additional cost associated with some of the things like the construction of a wall and the list of potential construction improvements that we have to make.
Mayor, members of council, as we understand it from the Arizona State Parks Executive Director, that those improvements will be made provided really by Arizona State Parks. They will contribute the funding to see that those projects are implemented.
Great.
Thank you.
Anything?
That's all I have.
Okay, anyone need a motion?
I make a motion that we approve item B of the consent agenda.
I'll second.
We have a motion and a second to approve item B of the consent agenda. Any other discussion? Hearing none, I'll call for the question. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
New business, item A, discussion approval, disapproval of the town council argument in favor of Proposition 408 to be placed on a special election publicity pamphlet. Mayor, members of the council, this is the time where we get to come before and look at this argument one more time prior to voting on whether this is the argument that you would like to submit for the publicity pamphlet. We have advertised arguments to be received by the public. We're putting out four different advertisements. To date, we have not received any arguments either in favor or against Proposition 408. Anyone who wants to submit an argument, they have until April 20th, 2016. And when you do submit an argument, it does require you to bring in a $200 deposit with the argument. And does anyone have any questions about the argument that has been submitted?
Just a clarification, you had stated April 20th, but in the packet it says arguments for or against ballot measures may be filed with the town clerk no later than 5 p.m. Monday, April 18th.
Well, April 18th would be the correct date, I believe.
Okay, I just wanted to clarify.
But the deadline says April 20th, 2016. I'm going to see if I made a typographical error in the in this item or in my advertisement that went to the paper, and that'll be the day we hold them for.
Okay, thank you.
Any other discussion? Need a motion?
I'll make a motion to approve the town council argument in favor of Proposition 408 to be placed in the special election publicity pamphlet.
I'll second.
We have a motion and second to approve the town council argument in favor of Proposition 408 to be placed in the special election publicity pamphlet. Any other discussion? Hearing none, I call for the question. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
Item B, discussion approval, disapproval of authorizing the town manager to negotiate and enter into a contract with Holbrook Asphalt Company to provide HA5 high density mineral bond pavement preservation treatment striping, crosswalks, and other lines and symbols on Merle Ranch Parkway in an amount not to exceed $175,139.81. Mr. Knutson.
Mayor, members of the council, before you is an item for your consideration on a pavement preservation for Merle Ranch Parkway from Hunt Highway to Felix Road. This is a product called HA5. It is from a Holbrook Asphalt Company. It'll allow the town to put a preservation treatment on Merrill Ranch Parkway. It'll be a very dark color. The contract also includes striping and symbols, and as well as traffic control on Merrill Ranch Parkway. The product was applied in other areas in the Anthem community, adjacent to Merrill Ranch Parkway is a Heritage Way, and it was applied in that area a couple years back and has held up really nicely. We're piggybacking up competitively bid pricing with the contract with the City of El Mirage, and we're asking for the council to approve a cost of $175,139.81.
Any member of the council have any questions? Need a motion?
I'll make a motion to authorize a contract with Holbrook Asphalt Company to provide HA5 high density mineral bond pavement preservation treatment, striping, crosswalks, and other lines and symbols on Merrill Ranch Parkway in an amount not to exceed $175,139.81.
I'll second.
We have a motion and second to authorize Holbrook Asphalt Company to do certain street work and not to exceed an amount of $175,139.81. Any other discussion?
Hearing none, I call for the question. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
Item C, discussion approval, disapproval of authorizing the town manager to negotiate and enter into a contract with Castus Asphalt through a Pinal County Cooperative contract to provide Palmer modified asphalt paving in an amount not to exceed $208,059.28. Mr. Knutson?
Mayor, members of the council, before you is more pavement preservation projects that we have going on potentially in the town of Florence. We're able to piggyback off of Pinal County's contract as well as some work that'll be going on in Pinal County if the council considers this moving forward on this project. Because the Cactus Asphalt's in the area, we'll be able to save on some mobilization costs and some other project management costs that would we'd otherwise pay to get this project completed. So that's a real nice opportunity for us to look at 3.7 miles of roadway in the Florence proper and south of proper. You're looking at Dogwood. Dogwood Road is proposed. Also, we have Butte Avenue that is east of Highway 79. We have Adamsville Road from Main Street past Plant Road and past the T.O. Village. And lastly, we have Orlando Street right in front of the K-8 school. We've identified these as some real key areas and a need for some immediate pavement preservation. The amount that's for your consideration, Mayor and members of the council, is $208,059.28. This includes a 10% owner's contingency. The previous item you had before you with the Holbrook contract also includes that 10% owner's contingency.
Any member of the council have any questions?
Yes. We've heard tonight from one of our citizens about the streets coming into downtown, First Street, 8th Street. What's the plan for all these downtown streets? You know, we're doing streets outside of town, and we're trying to do things for the downtown area.
That's in town.
And it's...
These are all in town.
They're all in town.
Oh, I know they're in town, but I'm saying, you know, how do we get into downtown?
Well, these particular roads, if you go look at them, they're pretty bad shape. They're a lot worse shape than the streets that Mr. Cheetah were talking about.
Do you think it's worse than First?
Pardon me?
You think they're worse than First?
First Street over here? Oh, yeah. First Street, I don't know. I don't think it's breaking up like Butte out there and Dogwood, but I'm not going to debate it. I'm not wanting to
debate it, Mr. Hawkins. You know, I just think that, you know, we are trying to, you know, we come in and we talk about what we're going to do to improve the downtown area, and we're not putting anything into that effort, you know.
We've done quite a bit downtown in the last few years. We just did the crosswalks, the sidewalk curb variations.
Now, I'm not talking about Main Street. I'm talking about the ability to get to Main Street.
Right. Well, a step at a time. I mean, I don't know.
These streets that we're talking about that Mr. Cheetah brought up, First and 8th Street, I'm sure are within our plan that we have and we've set in place due to the deterioration of the material that was down and the need for it traffic-wise. The one street that we didn't address on this that we should have addressed, in my opinion, is Florence Heights. Mm-hmm. That thing is the worst street in town.
It is. Yeah.
Now, my question to you, Jess, is we're using a different application than we're using out in the Anthem area. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay, that's all. I know you want to talk. Go ahead.
Mr. Mayor, members of council, there's a very, I have a very good technical answer to your questions. The application and the material that's going to be used on these roads is high volume. It's to be put on certain types of streets with a certain type of condition with a 5 to 7 year design time frame with a certain amount of structure underneath those streets and a certain type of damage. We're looking at Florence Heights very seriously, and we hope that we're in a financial position we can come back to you next year and have a comprehensive solution for Florence Heights. Florence Heights has some gigantic issues, including right-of-way, including drainage. We have to be mindful of those things from an engineering perspective before we spend good town dollars in there trying to fix that road, because it's an example of a road that has to be fixed correctly and not have another Band-Aid placed on it. So we're taking a very comprehensive look. As a matter of fact, I already saw an engineering concept last week on Florence Heights and have met with an engineer that did some design on it years ago from a hydrology perspective that can hopefully come to bear to help us from a drainage perspective. First Street. First Street's another priority. First Street is complicated because the utilities have to be repaired before we can repay First Street. It also has drainage problems. It also has massive failures that result from utility trenches. The technology that we will be utilizing on this would not be helpful on First Street because those utilities have to be repaired first, and those trench failures, including the intersections, have to be repaired first. It's not the proper technology or the proper application, and it's going to require significantly more money, time, and engineering to repair. It most certainly is on the highest strata in terms of priority in town, but not as simple of a solution as you're going to see on the streets that are listed above. And you'll notice that the cost for those other two roads will be an order of magnitude higher than this cost that we would be looking at for the type of methodology we'll be using on these roads.
And I think some of the things on 1st and 8th Street be cleaned up with beautification, some beautification work around there, and maybe a street sweeper going down there every once in a while. Just my own personal opinion. I mean, that's what I've observed.
Please understand, I don't object to what you're doing. I just would like to see us do more faster.
Well, and also that's where our plan comes into play, where it's helpful to see which roads are going to need to be in repair, how are they going to need to be in repair. For example, Brent, when you first started, you know, I took you on a tour because the Sun City area of the Anthem development had that fogging completed, and the other area of Parkside had not had that. There are some concerns because there's been some cracking that has occurred, some significant separation that has occurred, and the seal that they had put in it has already cracked and opened up. You also have over by the hospital, you know, you have flooding concerns. Anytime we have those torrential rains, the monsoons come in, it causes havoc.
Council member through the mayor, you'll notice that there, I'm colorblind, but I'm going to say purple. There's purple on this slide in addition to the yellow. I worked with our staff to determine what were the highest priorities in Anthem in terms of seal coat, and that was done by age, condition, wear, and fines loss. I actually went and drove it personally with our staff, and the area in pink is the second priority. As determined by real in-the-field work, that area has been crack sealed twice. I believe that's parcels 9 and 11, if I recall correctly. We also went out and got a price to do HA5 in that area, and we simply can't afford it. But in terms of the next priority in Anthem, according to our staff and myself, the purple should be done next, and we hope that we'll have the resources necessary to do that purple area next year. But that's the next, in terms of the whole subdivision, comprehensive analysis of the pavement, that area in purple should be preserved next after Anthem, or Merrill Branch Parkway, I think is what it's called. Right.
Yeah. Have we rode this horse?
Well, I want to point out that, which, you know, as we get the money, yeah, you know, I mean, there's a lot of stuff we need to do, but we're, under financial constraints right now, so we're doing our best,
That's a good question, Councilman Hawkins. Who is paying for this? Is this out of our state funds or is this out of our general funds?
HERF.
Is it out of HERF?
Sir, this is HERF funded. Yeah. Highway user revenue funds.
Yeah, good. Thank you.
Let's spend some money. I need a motion.
I'd like to make a motion to authorize the contract with Cactus Asphalt through a Pinal County Cooperative Contract to provide polymer modified asphalt paving in an amount not to exceed $208,059.28.
I'll second.
We have a motion and a second to authorize to contract with Cactus Asphalt through a Pinal County Cooperative Contract to provide polymer modified asphalt paving in an amount not to exceed $208,059.28. Any other discussion? Hearing none, I'll call for the question. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
Item D, discussion wrought regarding potential treatment at the intersection of North Main Street and adjoining crosswalks to properly accommodate equestrian traffic. Mr. Billingsley.
Mr. Mayor, members of council, interestingly that we just talked about pavement and that Main Street was brought up. But my understanding is there have been a number of things that have occurred regarding the intersections, specifically pedestrian crossings on Main Street over the last few years. There was a saw cutting of asphalt and concrete. There was decorative concrete. And my understanding is most recently there was a application of an epoxy-based coloring substance and cure put on those areas, which resulted in some challenges regarding parades, slickness after rainstorms. So most recently, it's my understanding that an abrasive course was placed in those crosswalks that I think was some type of aluminum silicate that was placed out there to reduce the opportunity for slippage in those crosswalk areas. But it's also my understanding that there was a test done, perhaps it was in a parade, I was not here at the time, and horses were still slipping and falling in those intersections. I was asked upon arriving in town to look at potential solutions so that the parades and the use of horses on these, particularly Main Street, could be restored as part of these events. For everyone in the public, there's a trailer, or there was a trailer, it might not be there anymore since I allowed the Public Works folks to leave, where we actually did some testing to sandblast some panels with the product on it to rough that up to see if it would be appropriate for horses. My understanding is the underlying substrate is stamped and colored concrete, so all the color would not be lost by sandblasting those areas, but that real slick surface and that sealant would be removed and it would be back to being concrete, which is what the street is now. And for any of you that were at the concert the other day and were dancing on it like me, you know that it's concrete in the middle of that street. It's not for a vote this evening, but I was asked by council to take a look at this and we provided a sample, if you will, for future council consideration, if you'd like us to bring that back for future consideration of sandblasting those decorative areas.
You know, I went out there and looked at that, and you're going to lose some color out of what's down now when you sandblast. But the three system on sandblasting seemed like it had more stickable. You didn't slide your hand when you went on it. And if we have to lose some color, we lose some color. But if it's for the safety, how can we have actually want a parade in town with horses in it if the people are afraid to ride their horses on Main Street because you're going to deal? Now, the other thing, you're not going to be able to dance on it after we sandblast it.
Like, just wear out your boots.
Well, yeah, you wear your leather out on your boots real fast.
Well, you know, I'm not as much concerned about the horses as I am the people, because I've slid across that street when it's wet.
And we didn't charge you for that either.
No, yeah.
See, that's a water slide, and we should have got you 15 cents or something. If we're going. The way that sandblasted out on that brick or on that concrete, there it was actually a little bit rough, and it'll be rougher as it goes because you're taking a lot of that coating off of it that was on there.
I think if I remember, Mr. Hawkins was the one who had some questions about the original being blended into the concrete on the streets. You couldn't tell where the crosswalks were.
And that was
one of the reasons for putting the color on there.
That's absolutely true, Council Member. One of the things that will be a detriment if you do the three-pass sandblast is without that sealant, without that dark color, the rubber from the tires and folks crossing there, it will dull, it'll turn black over time just from the traffic and the tires and what have you bet.
But maybe we need to paint the outside edges.
Yeah, because the way it looks right now, when they do the outside, it's going to be gray, just like the concrete.
Yeah.
But now the red was what I was talking about on the inside of the intersection. That comes out okay.
Yeah.
Is this something that council would like us to bring back? Would you like us to get some quotes and bring this back, or have we done enough?
I think the question would be just get it fixed. I mean, we got to get it fixed.
I think so.
Before we have some lawsuits on it, so just go ahead and do it. That's what your job is.
Okay, I know a little about concrete. I had no idea that they were going to put an epoxy coating on there. I thought they were going to put more stain on there. You can stain concrete after it's been poured. You can change the color.
Uh-huh.
I thought that's what they were going to do. The next thing I see, it's shiny and all that. Well, that wasn't what I requested. I requested the color, but you weren't here at that time. But yeah, it was a mistake. Yeah.
This price range that you give us is your amount to approve yourself.
Correct.
So I don't see the need for it to come back to council. I think you need to just fix it.
You're giving us direction to go ahead and fix it, and we will do that. We knew it as a staff. We knew this would be controversial, and we've heard that it's controversial. So I wanted to make sure that we were getting clear direction to go ahead and do it.
Well,
but how do you do it if you do sandblast it down? You know, I would like us to be in the loop of what you're going to do. Like, for example, how Mayor Rankin said, well, we can paint it red. Well, I'm going to give an example of, you know, the curbing. When you have a fire lane and you paint it red and a tire from a car goes up against it, it leaves marks. Is there a way to go back and do something, as Bill had mentioned, where you can still stain it even after you sand it down? So there's different things we have to look at, because we still want it to look presentable and nice, as well as have the safety functionality.
The estimates that we gave you aren't actual quotes, so we're not exactly sure what it's going to exactly cost, but we have a vendor that tells us it'll be in this ballpark. Clearly, it's within my authority if I receive direction tonight to sandblast. It's a whole other thing to restain that concrete. That's a much higher cost than what you have tonight.
Could staff maybe get with Scottsdale? If you go downtown Scottsdale.
This is the same product that they have in Scottsdale. I actually talked to the vendor today.
Which product?
The product that's out there right now that's shiny, that's what they've used in Scottsdale. Scottsdale has a sole source contract with the contractor that did this work.
Well, they have parades with horses.
They do.
Well, what do they do? Have we asked them?
They have this product with the aluminum on it that we have.
And they have no issues, no.
And they have no problem.
I haven't asked them if they have issues, but I do know that's in this contract.
Let's investigate it prior to going and sandblasting it down, and then have it come back.
Because theirs has been up there for years, and you know, I don't know if it gets black, if they pressure wash it every now and then. I don't know, but it looks nice, and I know they have horses in their parades also. So.
Do I have authority to sandblast? Because I'm confused now, or do you want me to bring it back?
Go find out the information from Scottsdale would be my suggestion. Come back and tell us what you've learned with some alternatives.
We can put it on another agenda and bring it back again.
Well, the parade is not until November anyway, so we got time.
Okay.
I just have one comment. I think the general public is used to seeing a clearly delineated crosswalk, and if in fact we just do the sandblasting, it looks pretty much like the roadway once traffic has gone over it. I would like to see the crosswalks marked the way the general public is used to seeing them.
Okay. As it stands now, there are three different colors, even if they sandblast it. There's one color in the middle of the intersection. There's one color where you walk, and then there are actually gray concrete sections in there that would constitute the lines under a typical street, just like Scottsdale, Glendale, Peoria, Mesa downtown. They all have the same thing without striping on top. So, I would suggest if you do decide you want to sandblast it, to see what it looks like after the fact and whether you think it's clearly delineated, and if it's not and it gets marked up, then maybe we plan to come back in with the thermoplastic in those areas.
And the thing to keep in mind too is paint on concrete wears off a lot faster than it does on asphalt. Yes. So it'll wear faster. So, okay, well, I guess you're gonna have to bring it back. Okay.
And reach out to Scottsdale to see what they do as well.
Okay, you got anything else you want to say in your manager report, or you done give it?
No, I do.
I got to go to work.
First one, and there'll be a press release that goes out tomorrow. I'll read into the record, and I need bifocals. On behalf of the Arbor Day Foundation, I write to congratulate Florence on earning recognition as a 2015 Tree City USA. Residents of Florence should be proud to live in a community that makes planting and care of trees a priority. Florence is one of more than 3,400 Tree City USAs with a combined population of 140 million people. Started in 1976, the Tree City USA program is sponsored by the Arbor Day Foundation in partnership with the U.S. Forest Service and the National Association of Foresters. It's celebrating its 40th anniversary this year. In honor of this milestone, a national public awareness campaign is being executed across the country, including a strong emphasis on media relations and social media contests, which are referenced as a tool in a toolkit received by your state coordinators. As a result of your commitment and effective urban forest management, you already know that trees are vital to the public infrastructure of cities and towns throughout the country, providing numerous environmental, social, and economic benefits. In fact, trees are the one piece of a community infrastructure that actually increases in value over time. So congratulations. Secondarily, I received this email this morning from Harvey Krause, who's the city manager of Eloy. Brent, thank you for allowing your staff to arrange the tour of your recreation library building on Wednesday morning. It's a very impressive facility, and I'm sure that your mayor, council, staff, and citizens are all very proud of it. Mayor Rankin and your council members were very gracious and hospitable. On behalf of Mayor Bellick and Councilmember Galindo and staff, I want to express our appreciation for the time that Brian, Lisa, and Rose took out of their busy schedules to visit with us. Thanks again. That's all I have.
Thank you. You have the your department reports in your packets. Is any questions?
Yeah, I have a couple questions.
I got to go.
One is on Mark's. He had a comment about updating the chicken/fowl rules. Want to make sure that we don't conflict with any of the HOA rules allowing chickens where the HOAs don't allow chickens. Okay. And let's see, I had one other comment. Oh, the other comment I had was for the police chief. In your report on citations, can you break out the parking citations separately? With all you're doing now, I'd like to...
Yes, we're going to break down on what areas of town, which beat had how many, and the areas.
Great.
We'll do that.
Thank you. That's all I have.
Any other? Okay, the second call to the public for public comment. Anybody in the public want to comment? Seeing none, I'll close call to the public. Call to the council, John.
Just had a comment from one of the residents in the apartments downtown. They started the renovation, and they're all quite excited about getting their homes renovated down there. They were really pleased with what was going on.
Good.
Good to hear that.
Beck?
Well, I just
I just wanted to agree with the mayor on 1st Street and 8th Street are very unsightly, and I don't think it has to do with the pavement or the roadways there. I think it has to do with the private property owners. Those need to be looked at very critically because it is a terrible sight to drive down those streets when you have beautiful, especially on 8th Street, where you have beautiful church and you have beautiful parks, and then you have homes that are unkempt, full of junk, and it really seriously needs to be looked at. That's all I have.
Bill? I just want to commend staff and all of our town employees that helped on the Road to Country Thunder. You did a great job. It was really, really good. Went off smooth. Karen?
I'll just concur with what Bill said. It was a great event. It was really nice to see so many people on Main Street having a good time.
Karen? Even if I can't remember your last name?
Okay, so those of you that may not have seen Road to Country Thunder, where Mayor Rankin forgot my name and then allegedly said that it was just so I can speak, I still really enjoyed speaking and singing happy birthday to the town of Florence along with your grandchildren. We have a lot of exciting things coming up. We also have a very important election ahead of us. We have several speaking engagements that we're going to be bringing to the communities. There was one this morning at Caliente. There's going to be one on the 6th at Sun City at 3 p.m. And then next Monday, we have a work session talking about our fiscal budget for anybody who wants to come and attend. It is an open session for you to listen, and I believe we'll have an opportunity for them to speak. And then lastly, on the 12th Anthem Parkside special election, we'll have a meeting at 7 o'clock in the evening. Town staff, you guys did an amazing job at Road to Country Thunder. Parks and Rec, you guys were up and down that street hustling and bustling. Really appreciate that. We also had a lot of volunteers from the community come out. The Pinal County, the Mounted Posse was there. Just overall great feeling. We had a long agenda tonight, so I'll pass it along to you.
Yeah.
Oh, wait, I'm sorry, I have one more thing.
I told you she liked to talk.
If anybody's interested in running, there's 3 council seats and a mayor seat, and packets are ready to be distributed from our town clerk, Lisa Garcia, during the business operation hours of 8 to 5. Got that.
Are you done?
I am.
Okay. One thing that upset me this week, and I'm going to tell you about it. Some of you may not know it. Saturday, as I was getting ready to come down to Country Thunder, I happened to drive by the Pinal County Courthouse over on Pinal Street. Administration Building 1. If you noticed, there was a little brick building around there. And the reason there was a brick building there, a little one, is inside that building was an adobe structure. I don't know how old or how many years it was. I don't know if it's back in the 1800s or it probably was right close there. It was being preserved by the county. Shippo had made comments. It's out of the historical district, but Shippo had made comments that it should be preserved. Well, lo and behold, the powers to be within county government Saturday tore the hell out of that building and tore it down. Now, why they did it without anybody getting a hold of the town, the historical district, Shippo, or whatever, I don't understand. That was something that'll never be replaced. It wasn't worth anything, but it was worth the history in it. And it could have been, I don't know if it'd ever been restored or not, and it wasn't very big. But it's the idea of tearing down these historical buildings that you won't see again. Another piece of our history went. We didn't see much of it anyway because it was all walled in. But it's just, I think it's ridiculous that they did it. They've already done it. There's no use crying over spilled beer, I guess. But I would like some communications with whoever. We need to be communicating with the county on these historical properties because the county buys more property around here than anybody. And if we're going in with some of these historical properties, that we're trying to preserve and save for future generations, the county's got to be a working partner with us. With that, need a motion.
Make a motion, we adjourn.
We have a motion and second adjourn. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. Motion carries, we're adjourned. Thank you for coming, ladies and gentlemen.